Hello, and welcome to Artist Forum. The purpose of this unpretentious symposium is to clarify some ideas that often occur in art history courses, such as the meaning of art, art and pleasure, art and beauty, distortion and beauty, and so on. Ideas that seem elementary at times and easy to grasp, while in reality, they are always hard to conceptualize and almost impossible to express with some conviction and originality. Let us begin with an expert on beauty. Praxiteles of Athens, the greatest of Attic sculptors in the 4th century BC, who transformed the 5th century style of detachment and majesty into one of gentle grace and sensuous charm. It was of this man that Diodorus said, he informed his marble figures with the passion of the soul. When I look at your Hermes, sir, my sense of beauty is satisfied, and yet I am still confused as to what beauty is.
Well, my mistress Pausanias once asked me to choose my most favorite and my most beautiful piece, and I had trouble deciding which one it was. I couldn't pick. I loved all of my works. So I told her this, and several weeks later, she came in running, and she told me that my studio was on fire, and there were flames everywhere. So not knowing what to do, I ran in, and I grabbed my Satyr and my Eros, two of my, I guess, my most beautiful statues, I would have to say, and I showed them to her, and she said, those are your favorites. So among those two, she chose my Eros, and she said that was definitely the most beautiful work.
And why did you choose those two?
Probably because of their the sweet classical style that I developed with softer lines and rounder edges and a new definition of light and shading.
Okay, let's go on to Lysippus. Lysippus was also a Greek sculptor of the 4th century BC and was praised by ancient authors for replacing the canon of Polykleitos with a new set of proportions that produced a more sinewy, slender body and a smaller head. Now, let's take your Epoxymenos, or the scraper. Why do you think that would be beautiful?
Well, I think that the Epoxymenos is a beautiful work because I feel that it shows the human body as it is perceived by other humans rather than as it is. Now, this may perhaps seem complicated, but what I have attempted to do in my work is to get away from the classical style of the sculptors of the 5th century who used a rigid intellectual analysis of the human body and sculpted mathematically correct figures. And the thing is that if you put together perfect individual parts, they don't necessarily add up to a body which is realistic. And what I also tried to do is to sculpt the human body as it is seen in an instant. And this can be shown by the fact that the Epoxymenos is in a position which you cannot keep for a long time. And finally, I also tried to sculpt the body as in a three-dimensional manner. And this can be shown by the fact that the Epoxymenos has a well-sculpted back and that it is meant to be seen from all sides instead of merely from the front.
So would you say that realism has something to do with beauty, or the way something is realistic, how realistic it is, could make it beautiful?
Yes, I definitely think so. And I also feel, by the way, that endowing sculptures of humans with godlike traits is not really desirable, because I don't feel that this is truly realistic, even though I do feel that these sculptures should be endowed with some sense of dignity.
Thank you. Ghiberti, your works and writings form the basis of much of the style and aims of the High Renaissance. You created, in your first major work, the bronze doors of the Florence Baptistry. These doors were so beautiful that Michelangelo dubbed them the Gates of Paradise. Ghiberti, what is beauty?
Well, I guess my first realization of beauty came with an interest in new humanistic ideals, and this prompted my admiration of the classical sculpture and any new discovery in this field. And so in my autobiography, which is called The Commentaries, I don't know if you've read it, but I wrote of my great enthusiasm for classical sculpture and this also spurred my collection of this type of sculpture. I really admire this type of sculpture because I think it really, really symbolized beauty because of its harmony of proportion, its smoothness and grace in dealing with the human body, and also it's got a certain ease and balance pertaining to sculpture. So I used this type of sculpture and my own unique style to establish the Renaissance art and sculpture. And in my first competition, though, which beauty really, to win, you had to have a beautiful sculpture in the doors, of, or in the bronze doors, I pretty much used Pisano, which was, he made doors before me, as a guide. And this helped me to visualize what I had to do, but it also let me kind of experiment on my own. And with the competition that I had, I really was just kind of looking to please the judges, so I couldn't really kind of use my own style. But after winning against such superb artists and rivals, such as Brunelleschi, I gained an inner confidence, and from then on I could kind of incorporate my own ideas and creativity and patience, since I had more time, into my own works. And let's see, to show beauty, I pretty much incorporated high, medium, and low reliefs to give like a certain effect with nearness at the figures and where and their face and their space, like their space. And I think that helped with beauty. And I also stress light. Nothing is seen without light. That's very obvious, but I think that light is essential to really show the figures in the sculptures, color and just their beauty. And I think because of my meticulous inspection of my works and my patience, I think this really helped with beautifying the attitudes of my figures and the sculptures. So.
See. Let's move on to Verrocchio. Now, Verrocchio, you were a respected Florentine painter and sculptor in the early Renaissance. And when I look at your equestrian statue of Colleoni, I notice that it resembles Donatello's Gattamelata. Is there an aspect of beauty you were trying to achieve that was missing from Donatello's statue?
Yes, definitely. I wanted to entail more movement into my equestrian statue. I think that Donatello's was too stagnant. It was very subdued, and although it properly conveyed the dignity of battle and of victory, I don't think it showed the intensity of the movement. I want my my sculptures, when viewers look at it, I want the viewers to be able to feel all the movements. I want them to feel the muscle strain and the intensity of the movement, and I want it to affirm life rather than affirm the ideals of life. I think that my sculptures should be inspiring, but they should be able to go through all the movements of the sculpture without actually having to do the effort themselves.
So realism, again, would be your a factor in beauty?
Realism of movement. I think that anything which properly conveys the movement, such as like the line and form, are very important to convey a certain movement, but not necessarily just of the figure itself. I mean, if the line is there, but the movement isn't, then I don't think that would be beautiful.
I see. Thank you. Mantegna. Next to Masaccio, you're the most important painter of the earliest Renaissance because of your unique style you created called the illusionistic fresco. Sir, with your slightly different use of perspective, in St. James led to the execution, what were your thoughts on beauty?
Well, my basic thoughts on beauty are that since I'm a great fan of classical art, such as Greece and Rome, those styles, I think that a classical beauty is beauty. And I think that in my St. James led executioner, I think that I incorporated a lot of movement into my painting, and I think that also in my St. Sebastian, I think that I have included emotion and a lot of atmospheric perspective to incorporate it all into classical beauty.
So perspective would have a lot to do with beauty.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, let's ask an expert on perspective. Brunelleschi. Brunelleschi, you were one of the architects, one of the first architects to make use of the scientific principles of perspective, and you're generally credited with as the creator of the Italian Renaissance style of architecture. In your cathedral, San Lorenzo, what is that beautiful? What makes that beautiful?
Well, do you want me to hold this? Well, my goal was definition and codification of painter's perspective, and I reached that by my intense interest in mathematical articulation of form. And to me, the most beautiful thing is perspective and is the geometric precision of the light and the spatial depth. I think that my buildings were beautiful because they had an elegance that was natural and was scientific at the same time. There was a geometric space that was actually perfect, and to me that was the most important aspect of beauty, not necessarily the ideals or the movement, but in its complete precision and how the light played off that precision.
Brunelleschi, do you feel that the perfection, the geometric perfection you strive for in your works is perhaps influenced by the perfection of heaven?
I don't think so, no, because what I'm dealing with is math and not the glorification of man in a heaven. This is what is happening naturally. These are laws. This is not something that can be glorified or prayed to.
But Brunelleschi, doesn't it take man, divinely inspired by his God, to formulate laws and to recognize them in nature?
Well, that is true, but they occur without man. If man were not there, these laws would still exist. Man found them and discovered them, but they had to be discovered. They didn't have to be invented.
Thank you.
Now, Giotto, you were the greatest painter immediately preceding the Renaissance, and you were known for your arrangement of groups and the vividness of gestures of your figures. You're also a renowned sculptor and a chief architect in the building of the Florentine Chapel. Now, with the basis of all three areas of art that we're discussing today, what is beauty?
Well, I believe that I capture the essence of beauty most in my paintings. I really have a great deal of respect for nature, and I believe that beauty lies in nature. And man, as the pivotal point of nature, is where beauty is concentrated. So as you said, I do try and render my figures with very realistic emotions and facial expressions and gestures so that I can capture the psychology of man, which I deem beautiful, and also relate my figures to the people who view it in order to show my respect for their inner beauty. There's an inner relationship that must take place between man and the work of art that he's viewing, and it's a natural relationship, and in that, it's beautiful.
I see.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so the relation between the painter and the viewer,
yeah,
is part of the beauty of the painting or of the whole experience.
Yeah, I truly believe that, and I think that I take a lot of effort in making my compositions harmonious and varied, and so I also try to keep them simple, and so in taking that care, I've tried to further relate my paintings to the person who's viewing it, and it's just as all integrated into that respect for man and man as a pivotal point of nature.
I see. Thank you. Let's go back to perspective for a minute. You were a prominent artist of the early Renaissance who experimented greatly and made advances in both the use of foreshortening and linear perspective. I look at your painting, The Battle of San Romano, and I notice your great use of perspective. Does perspective affect or make beauty?
Yes, I believe that perspective makes beauty, because in my pictures, The Battle of San Romano, I used a lot of geometric forms, and I interconnect them into each other, which makes it more abstract, and the perspective does a lot to that. And I also like to use a lot of dramatic color, which are like outlined, and this creates a rhythm, which organizes them into a unity. Sorry. And I also like, the perspective also renders the space. It makes it more unique. And I also like to use a lot of details, which would crowd them together, so you make them think a lot when you look at the painting.
Okay. Botticelli. You were from Florence, Italy, and a favorite of the Medici family in the early Renaissance. Your paintings are characterized by a subjective, almost abstract approach and an emphasis on line rather than mass. You are the master of delicate lines. Now, in The Birth of Venus, what that's hailed as your greatest painting, what makes that beautiful?
I think there are different parts of it that make it beautiful. I do focus, as you say, on the line. I find beauty in motion, in movement, in line, and I enjoy exploring new ways to create a feeling of movement in a picture, which obviously has none. I focus as little as I can on color and on light because I prefer to look at the line of a figure. I find beauty in the human form. I find beauty especially in the figure of in women's figures, and I think that my Venus was perhaps the quintessential figure of a woman, and I think that it has been said as my best painting also because it has symbolism and interest just beyond the picture.
Now, the symbolism, you're a Neoplatonist, and Neoplatonism is the struggle to reconcile classical philosophies with the Christian religion. Could you explain that a little bit more for the audience?
Well, as a Neoplatonist, I find beauty in the classicalism of Roman and Greek art, but I also find inspiration and beauty in religion, especially in God's love and in God's creation of nature. So in my paintings, I try to combine these two. I also am fascinated with Greek and Roman mythology, which you can see because I've painted both of those, but I've also painted religious themes. And it's Neoplatonism, one of the ideas is that Christianity and the Greek and Roman myths can live together harmoniously, and I can paint both of them without sacrificing my Christian values.
Okay. Would you say symbolism is not necessary to beauty, but is a definite factor in beauty? Or does symbolism need to be there for to have a beautiful art piece?
I think symbolism provides interest. I think symbolism provides intellectual stimulation. I don't necessarily think that beauty comes from symbolism. I think that beauty comes more from the form and the line and the emotion that is expressed in a painting.
Okay.
Can I ask a question on Botticelli and Brunelleschi? It seems to me that your ideal of spiritual beauty and your ideal of capturing secular beauty are somewhat in conflict. How do you reconcile each other's views? Do you have any feelings?
Well, I definitely feel that there are different perspectives of what beauty is. My form of beauty, I have very little perspective in my paintings. My backgrounds are very simple because I choose to focus on just the figures in my paintings, but I don't think that that means that the beauty in my paintings renders anyone else's paintings not beautiful.
Brunelleschi, would you like to comment?
I would agree with that. And I would say that although I find my beauty, to me, it is ideal, but I can still appreciate her beauty, which is very different, but she puts just as much care and effort into hers, which itself is beautiful.
Okay. Shakespeare said that beauty was in the eye of the beholder. Does it take education to know beauty, or can the common man just look at a painting and know it's beautiful, even if he doesn't know why?
Well, I personally feel that the common man should be able to look at beauty and know it, because I myself believe that beauty occurs in nature, and so that I feel that man himself should naturally know when he sees beauty.
I would have to agree with Isippus. I think, as I said earlier, that beauty does occur in nature, and the job of a master artist is to capture the psychology of man and have man be able to recognize it. However, I think with education, one can develop an appreciation of art and beauty on different levels. There's like an emotional connection made, but then there's also an intellectual one that can be made as well.
I would agree with that. And when you walk into one of my churches, you should be struck by a feeling of awe, no matter what your level of education. Just the form itself should be very impressive without you knowing the laws, because very few people do know the laws. But as Giotto said, there are different levels, and I think that your appreciation of a certain beauty is enhanced by your education.
Anyone else? Let me just try to wrap this up for the audience then. I think what we've established here today is that even though there are different opinions of beauty, that you can know what is beautiful, and that there's a certain beauty in naturalism, symbolism, realism, and and beauty is in the eye of the beholder, and even if you don't understand why it's beautiful, you can know something is beautiful. I'd like to thank the artist for coming today. I know some of you had to come a long way, and I'd like to thank you for that. Thank you, and good night.